Ishmael by Daniel Quinn. This story starts off by an important ad that was sent out in a newspaper that says teacher seeks people. The only condition is that the person must desire to save the world. The narrator sees this ad and goes crazy because that's all the narrator has ever wanted to do. And this narrator goes days finding this teacher, and he worries he's not going to find the teacher on time. He believes there's going to be more people. And finally, he finds the teacher, but he finds a surprise before this. He finds a gorilla, an animal, in the building, and it doesn't stop there. It keeps on going because the narrator finds that he can understand what the gorilla is saying just by looking at him, just by understanding him. He can understand everything he's saying because he's an animal. You know, animals can't talk, but at this point, he can understand everything he's saying. Later on in the story, we see that the gorilla, which is named Ishmael is trying to explain to the narrator all the myths that we've been told to this day of how to live life and how we live. So he shows many stories, he shows many analogies of how the world is being brought and how we've just been taught different things. And I'll be sharing two things that I found unique and interesting because, you know, this whole story, this whole book right here has so many examples of what we've been taught in the past. And I just wanted to share too. So one would have to be one that was short, but I kind of just added on a little bit to it, which would have to be the jellyfish story. We've always been taught that the man is, you know, the final product of evolution. The man is the most important part of the world. I mean, we just think of the world and we think of humans as the center of the world. And in this book, it talks about how Ishmael explains how it's not that way. The man is not the final product of evolution. And when this is why I chose it. I chose this because when I read that part, I was like, then what is it, you know? And it being interpreted as a jellyfish made me wonder furthermore into it, like how does this happen? How, why? You know, it makes you think how this could be possible. That's a great example of what is being taught, what the teacher, which is Ishmael, is bringing to the point of how to save the world. Because I think evolution is one of the most important parts of trying to save the world. So that was one of them. And second would have to be one of also the first one was a small part of what was being explained, but the second one was a little bit bigger in the aspect of the tree of evolution, of the tree of knowledge, I'm sorry. So first, Ishmael explains the relationship between Adam and Eve. First, you know, we've all been taught the story of between these two and the tree of knowledge. We were taught that, you know, Adam and Eve were the first people on earth. Well, first it was Adam and then Eve was created. But the funny thing is Ishmael questions everything. Ishmael questions how Adam means man. And if Adam means man, we think that Eve means woman. Well, it's not. Eve means life, which is, you know, the crazy part of the story. When I read this, I thought this was crazy. I mean, all my life, I was born as a Catholic, still am a Catholic, and this was always the way life was. And even if you're not religious, you know that this was the way life was. And we see this point brought by the levers, because in the story we talk about takers and levers. Levers are the ones that started everything back thousands of years ago, decades years ago. They're the ones that kind of started everything. Well, right now there's not many that are still left, versus takers, which is basically us. what we have taken, what we're practicing now, what we take from what was left. So that's how it explains. So we see this version from the weavers, because we see that the Bible has to do a lot with what we're taught, and but basically Ishmael kind of discovers the truth that no version of the Bible is telling the actual story of the tree. You know, we see that once they take the bite of the apple, the good and the evil starts. It's forbidden. It begins. What would have happened if they wouldn't have ate the apple? Or what happened if it wasn't forbidden? You know, what would happen if God didn't say, do not eat the apple? We talk about in the book further more into it, you know, and then we see how it would have been different if the takers would have explained it. And then furthermore into the story, we see another analogy, which is the story of the fall, if the takers would have been explaining the story. So those are the two unique, interesting examples that I found. Then what I loved about the book, I loved many things about this book. I thought it was amazing. It's very heartwarming, to the point where it made me cry. And I'm starting to get teary again, because I still remember it was like page 12. I'm reading this book and I look up and I'm only on page 12 and I start to cry. I think it was beautiful that they put a gorilla as the teacher, because, you know, if a human tells you this, you're gonna think, wow, this is amazing. They finally discovered the truth, the ugly truth that's being told. But since they put an animal, especially a gorilla, it just amazes you, because the gorilla is not playing the rules. The gorilla is an outsider. And not just is he an animal, but I mean, not only is he an outsider, but he's an animal. We know that humans are the center of the world, and humans are taught this, and humans are taught that. Humans, like, everything is made for humans, but what about animals? You know, they're always the secondary, they're always last. You know, we're always put first. But when an animal has something to say about it, you know, it really touches you, because animals don't speak, animals don't feel, animals this and that. And I just think it was amazing how, only on page 12, we're being taught everything of what this animal felt and what he feels. You know, on page 12, he explains why do people keep calling me this? Like, he was receiving stares at the zoo. Kids, you know, screaming Goliath. Like, is that all they know him as? Just Goliath. You know, that's what I loved about the book. Many things. But that was the main point that I loved. What I believe I disliked, because I don't think I hated it, I disliked a little bit the literature that's being taught in the book. I think it's amazing the way it's being portrayed, like, because, you know, like, the words that are said are very beautifully said. I feel like you can't even, like, explain it less. But since this book was written in, like, 1992, you kind of get, like, a little lost. You know, I'm personally not a big reader. I read about, like, 2-3 books a year, which is not a lot compared to a lot of other people. And I got a little bit lost in some parts. I would have to reread the page again, reread the paragraph again, kind of to understand a little bit more. Especially if you don't know the stories. Like, if you didn't know the story of Adam and Eve, you would have to, like, research a little bit about it. Mostly everybody knows it, but you can get a little lost. So it's definitely a lot to handle. But I think that the narrator did a good job between splitting chapters. You know, you would read 10 pages and then another chapter. Like, that was kind of what happened in the middle of the book. So that kind of helped. But just that was the only thing that I disliked about the book, being a little bit too hard to sometimes understand, to not get lost in a few things. Let's see. Then, I believe that, Mr. Harvey, I believe that, you assigned this book because not only is this book kind of relating to the course about animals, you know, we've talked about being sustainable. I think that you assigned this book because you truly wanted to open up our eyes and see the myths that are being told, and I really truly thank you for that, because this is one of the best books I've ever read, and You know, I truly believe that everyone should read this book. Like, it should be taught in schools, just like we have to read certain schools, certain books in schools. I believe this is one of them. And it's just amazing the way it's portrayed. And it questions the way we live, definitely, because, you know, I feel like I'm not the only one. I feel like there's a lot of people that kind of question life. We've always questioned how did it start? Why do we live this way? We kind of live by the book. We live by kind of a script. We live by the day. You know, we're taught this, we're taught that, but why? Why are we taught this way? And this really opens our mind and why this happens. But I also believe that Daniel Quinn, as you mentioned, he wrote this book having a theology and anthropology degree. So this makes perfect sense. After I finished reading, then I looked into it. Those two degrees, and it makes perfect sense of why he wrote this book. Anthropology being what makes us human. He talks about that. You know, he talks about how evolution. He talks about those like main points in the story. So it makes perfect sense of why he would write this book. You know, because that's how it all starts. The theories and myths and everything. And then a second, which is most importantly, is theology, I'm so sorry, which is the nature of God and religious belief. I mean, that's, he's learning about how the world is portrayed, what we believe in, you know, the religious beliefs, because, you know, you don't have to be religious to understand these concepts. We all know, like, the Adam and Eve story, which is an amazing example. Religion plays a big part in this book and in life. I mean, even if you're not religious, like I mentioned, it's always going to be there, and religion is always going to be difficult with science. Like, I strongly believe in science, and a part of me, you know, I've always grown up with religion, and I like to keep in religion in the picture, but you know, science beats religion, definitely, but it makes perfect sense. And lastly, I believe this book did make me have hope for the world. It's very hard to kind of explain how, because, you know, like, we just see that humans treat the environment like we put ourselves first. I feel like it would be hard to have humans slowly change the world, because we are not, by reading this book, we kind of understand the concept, but it's going to be very hard for people to change it, because we are taught this way. We are taught this way, and we think it's going to be very hard to kind of, I can't put the words in my mouth, have everyone go back and say, you know what, this is what we were taught before is not true. You know, if only if it was as easy as just recycling. Okay, I think it's easy, but a lot of people don't need it. You know, we can't just be like, okay, well, instead of driving to work, we're gonna ride a bike. No, we would have to re-explain this. I feel like it would just take step-by-step process to have hope to save the world slowly, just like Ishmael did with the narrator. It was a sad ending, but I think it was brought into beautiful words, because you know, the modern society is just, it's upsetting how human supremacy is basically superior, and it shouldn't be that way. Animals' lives matter, they really do. And I just think this book was beautiful. I really do have hope for the world, and I really hope that so we can slowly change the world, and we can slowly open up people's eyes. So thank you very much for this book. I'm sorry if I talk too much. 15 minutes is truly not enough to talk about this book. It's amazing. This is an amazing book. I love it. I'm so sorry. But yeah, with Gorilla gone, will there be hope for me? Thank you, and have a wonderful day.